Okay, here we go.
Hi, this is Amanda Zeem. I'm going to try to change my name on here. Let's see if I know how to do that.
Okay, yeah. If you could mute in the meantime, please.
I will. Do you guys know how to change the name on here?
I think you click in the upper, there's like a box in the upper right hand corner of your screen. Maybe you can click on that.
All right, we'll figure it out. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'd like to call to order the Tuesday, November 9th, 2021 meeting of the Evanston Preservation Commission. We do have a quorum of, I think, actually all commissioners right now. In order to proceed virtually, we need to suspend the rules otherwise requiring live participation. If one of the commissioners could please move to do so.
I move to suspend the rules and allow a virtual meeting.
Second. Thank you. A roll call vote. Commissioner Reinhold.
Aye.
Commissioner Sullivan.
Aye.
Commissioner Thomas. I mean, Commissioner Morris. Jeez. Is Jamie still on? Looks like she signed off.
Commissioner Jamie Morris is not going to be present. She wanted to make sure that there was a quorum.
Right, thank you. Commissioner Cohen?
Aye.
Commissioner Jacobs?
Aye.
Commissioner Bowden?
Aye.
Commissioner Dreller?
Aye.
And I'm an aye. So for those of us who haven't appeared before the commission, for each matter that we call, the applicant will introduce themselves and proceed to present their application. You can direct Cade as to, you know, turning the pages and going your way through it. I think there's an opportunity to screen share if you have additional materials. After that, we'll have an opportunity for the commissioners to ask questions of the applicant. We'll then have an opportunity for participation by the public. We'd ask that each member of the public who wishes to speak limit their presentation to 2 minutes. As you begin, please introduce yourself. Even though your name does appear on Zoom, we need to have, you know, everyone's name stated in the recording in case people want to listen to the recording. And we'll then have any additional discussion by the commission and then a roll call vote on each matter. If everyone who's not speaking could please mute, that would be a big help. Thank you. The first matter of business was a matter of old business that was continued, 1233 Judson Avenue in the Lakeshore Historic District.
Hi, it's Nate Kipnis. I'm the architect. Can I share my screen?
Let me see. You should be able to, Nate.
Okay. So I have two things to go over. One is the update to the actual plan, and then I had been asked to give a short presentation on window efficiency. So the first item is this building at 1233 Judson. We had, I'm just going to forward to the new part. So we were adding the solar array on the south, so that has not changed. We have the proposed roof deck and a slight low slope roof to get access to that roof deck. We did update the railing, which I'll show you in a rendering in a minute. And then we have the windows. Where we left off last time was that the windows that are not visible to the front of the building would be replaced with a casement window that has detailing to look like a double hung. And then the windows that are visible from the front would be upgraded existing windows. So I'm just going to flip to the pertinent parts. This is the roof deck. Nothing here has changed. The railing design did, and I'm gonna just go all the way to the end to show that to you. So this is a rendering. I'm gonna zoom in a little bit. So this shows the railing up at the top, not very visible. We reduced the width of the supports that was requested last time. And that's the view that you would see from the front. These would be the windows that would be repaired and upgraded. And the windows on the side of the building and in the back would be the ones that would be new. So I didn't go through all the drawings, but they're basically the same as what we had before, other than the windows were modified as I just discussed. So I'd like to have any questions on this, and then I would go into that presentation afterwards.
Doesn't sound like they're questions.
Railings look very nice. They're lighter looking and better proportioned.
Thank you.
And just a question for the windows that are on the front room right there that juts out, all three sides of those, and those windows will be
correct. Everything that you can see from the front. So it would, if you could shift the building and look to the north a little bit, there's another set of windows that are identical to what you're seeing flanking. And then yes, all three sides of the bay. And then the building goes back. You can see this in plan. Let me get to this. So you can see my cursor, right?
Yes.
So all the windows around here and then to here.
Okay, thank you.
It sounds now like there are no questions. If you want to proceed, please.
Yeah, I could go to that presentation. Let's see. So I also have on the line Andrea Lynn, who's an intern with us, who has an environmental engineering degree. So she did a lot of the research on this. So if I mess up, she will catch me and correct me. But so I was asked to look at the environmental impact of existing double hung windows with storm windows, new double hungs, and then we put in the new casements. So there's two things we're looking at. One is operational carbon, and that's the carbon that is used for the energy to heat and cool the home. And then the embodied carbon is the carbon that's used to manufacture the windows and get them on site and replace them. So the difference between embodied and operational, embodied is shown as the orange here. So it's consistent. It starts at the beginning of the building and it stays until whatever that part is that's replaced. So if a window is being replaced, there'd be a jump in this orange section. The operational carbon is additive every year, assuming the weather basically stays the same. So it takes on that shape. The embodied carbon of wood windows, we're just gonna look at the typical 24 by 36 window, is about 22 kilograms of CO2 equivalent. And then what has to be replaced every 30 years is the flat glass, the glass itself. It's not like the window would be replaced. So it's about a third, a little over a third of the window unit. You're going to see this is incredibly small number compared to the operational carbon. So just remember that 22 kilograms and about 8 kilograms. And then we have the main culprit is the air infiltration in a double hung. So at the sash meeting rail, we get a lot of airflow and then around the perimeter. So there's just a lot more points compared to a casement window. We looked at that two different ways, the leakage per linear foot of crack length and the leakage per area of window. So we got slightly different results, but they're not that much different. And so the linear crack is just literally every line around here. And then the area is just the area of the window. This is the method one with the leakage per linear crack foot. And so the existing double hung windows have an R value just a little bit over one. And the air infiltration is about 2 cubic feet per minute per foot. If we add storm windows, we more than double the R value and we cut down that infiltration rate, not quite in half, but close. New double hung windows, it's maybe a little, probably more like 3.5 to 4 would be the R value, but could be with really high performance, could be up to four, a little over four. The air infiltration is 0.8. And on new casement windows, that infiltration rate drops even further. And this is, again, is the leakage per linear crack foot. So it's about 9 times better on the infiltration rate. Then what we did is we modeled one of the units at 1233 with all the windows in there in the area. And we put in those values. And what we got out was on an annual basis about 18,500 kilograms of CO2 being used. And that was with the existing double hung windows. So we ran this for each of those four options. And this is what we ended up with. So for the existing double hung windows, like I said, about 18,500. When you put in new storm windows, you get about 1.5 times better. With new double hungs, you get about 2.5 times better. And with that case, with new casement windows, you get 7.5 times better. And what that looks like on a chart over the 100 years. And remember, I mentioned that the window replacement was like 22 kilograms. So that's absolutely not going to show up on this chart. This is in the 1 million and 2 million kilogram range. So the new casement windows, even if we replace the window every 30 years or replace the glass, it's not really going to make a difference. But the new casement at the bottom you see is the 7.5 times better. And the double hung, if it's new, 2.5, and the restored is 1.5. If we did the other method, we get slightly different, but not crazy different. But what's interesting is the air infiltration on an existing double hung at 2 cubic feet per square foot compared to a new casement, which is 100 times better, 100 times tighter. And so that increased this when you take all that into account. 1.5 times still for the existing window with the storm, but 5 times better with the double hung and 8.5 times better with the casement window. And that changes the chart slightly. And when we averaged them, we just took those two results and averaged them. We get, again, 1.5 times better with the storms, 3 times better with the double hung, and 8 times better with the casement window. So it's pretty interesting to see it this way. And I'm happy to share this with the board. These are the resources that we utilized. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to go over that.
That's great. Does anybody have any questions on it?
Nate, basically your conclusion is that replacing old windows from an energy point of view is so much better than trying to restore them or adding storm units. Is that correct?
It makes a significant difference. Yeah, and I mean, when we try and do ultra high performance buildings, this is the weak link, it's always trying to tighten the building up. And, you know, we do a really good job at it. And I know these guys at Passive House are taking it to such a wild level. It's almost like a submarine. Of course, there's the airflow, you know, the bringing in fresh air and everything. But you couldn't possibly have a Passive House with anything but something like that casement window.
Okay, Nate, if I understand the proposal for the building is that you're restoring the front windows as a kind of a gesture of respect, I guess, for the building, its history, its look, and feelings of a lot of the commissioners, and that everything else will be new high efficiency windows.
That's what we had talked about last time. I would like to hear, you know, I mean, if I had my way, I would have new casement windows. And I think this is pretty clear, the difference, depending on which one of these you look at, it's easy, you know, it's millions of kilograms of CO2 over its lifetime. It's pretty amazing. It depends on which way we model it. This one isn't quite as impactful, but it's still very noticeable.
I was just curious on the new double hung, is the assumption a new wood double hung, you know, like the same type of double hung that's there?
Yeah, you know, so a new window is going to be much tighter than an old one. I mean, I've restored old windows, and I know when they do it correctly with all the copper components and everything, it's pretty good. It's actually quite good, but it's not to the level of like a new double hung. And the reason the casement is even better, and it's funny on this graph, because like the 5 to 8.5 doesn't show up quite as dramatically, but it is a big difference. The casement is shutting like a refrigerator door. It's gasketed. There's no places for it really to leak. And that's where that kind of 100-fold or 100-time increase is in infiltration. So even compared to a new double hung, it's still quite a difference. There's nothing better than, well, a fixed window would be the best. But essentially, a casement is homing in on that.
Okay. From an aesthetic point of view, it should be pointed out that casements and double hungs look very different because the upper sash is in a different plane than the lower sash in a double hung. Even with a with a simulated meeting rail on the casement, it still is a different look. At some point, as a commission, I think we should collectively grapple with this. I think Nate has made a very convincing case, and I think that for building, in my view, for buildings which are not landmark, but merely contributing structures, we should be flexible about replacement of old windows with new windows. Although in this case, I think Nate, by proposing to restore the windows at the front of the building, is probably, looking to satisfy everyone's disparate interests.
So this is my old house that we moved out of a little while ago. And so this, we had double hungs here and they didn't meet egress. So we had to put casements in for egress, and we went ahead and made them look like this. So yeah, absolutely what you're saying is correct, that they're out of, they're in line, they're in plane. And, you know, anyone that knows what they're looking at would see that. But I didn't want to just put casements in here, so we did that.
All right. Is there anything else you wanted to present before we move on?
Nope, that's it.
Thanks. That was very helpful. Was there any?
I was just going to say that. Oh, I'm sorry. I should let everybody else speak. I was going to say that if Cade would put up the verbiage, I'd make a motion to accept this.
Let's just make sure that. Okay. Was there any member of the public who wanted to speak to this matter? Was there any other member of the commission who wanted to discuss any issue?
Yeah, I do think this is a tough case because, well, I respect the efforts to make a house, make a structure energy efficient and to take advantage of where, of how far these opportunities have come. And that this property is not a landmark property. I'm still grappling with the standards 1 and 2 for alteration, where, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think the windows that are being replaced, they aren't in terrible condition. And I like that. I think like a good concession is to go ahead and restore the ones on the front and then consider the ones on the sides and the back, you know, the secondary elevations. But then I just go back to the fact that they're still in good, we have original wood windows in fair to good condition. And I just keep getting stuck there. And so I think for myself, I'll probably be voting nay, just based on those standards 1 and 2.
I mean, I think it, you know, it would, I mean, I think as part of our efforts to have standards that reflect sustainability issues, you know, I think there'll be an opportunity moving forward to discuss this and weigh all these factors that, you know, certainly agree, but we don't have any real precedent for. There's certainly some analogy to, you know, a completed project, the solar panels, where we had what really is a compromise where we've, you know, strongly discouraged the panels that are strongly visible on the front facade, but you know, allowed, you know, something that the type of, you know, appearance that normally you wouldn't have in a historic district on less visible facades. And it just, you know, I think as Stuart said, it's a conflict. It's two interests that do conflict with each other, and I'm not sure there's any way to reconcile them. But I agree that it's important to think it out and, you know, have a plan going forward.
Can I add something? So I have served on a number of committees at the AIA. I was the national co-chair of the 2030 commitment. I was on the Sustainable Leadership Committee, and now I'm on the Committee for Climate Action and Design Excellence. And I mean, the good thing about being on these committees is I can see what's coming for the next 5+ years. And this is definitely an issue that is moving forward quickly. So this building is, we're trying to decarbonize the entire thing. So all the gas lines are gonna be cut. It's gonna be all electric, the solar, battery backup, EV charging. So, I mean, we're really trying to, I think this will be a great case study, and I'd be happy to report back on how it's doing. But I think this is interesting to do half the building this way and half the building the other way and see what actually happens with that.
Can you hear me okay? Can everyone hear me? Yeah. I had a question. What's the plan for the windows that you are taking out?
I didn't catch that.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. What are the what's the plan for the windows that you're taking out?
I'm not sure I got that. I'm really sorry.
I'm experimenting with this. It's not working. Can you hear, you can hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what is the plan for the windows that you are taking out?
I imagine we're going to contact Evanston Rebuilding Exchange and see if they'll take them. I don't know if they will, but I. You know, certainly that would be the first effort.
I mean, recycling them is part of this effort, as you
know. Oh, yeah. No. It's energy, it's health, it's materials, it's, you know, everything we're trying to do. And yeah. Not going to put them in a landfill if we can help it.
And I'm just curious, some of your data was based on, or maybe it wasn't based on, but you noted in your presentation, for the newer windows, while they get replaced every 20 to 30 years, you were saying it's only really the glass that needs to be replaced. Have you seen any projects where you have just replaced the glass? Usually when I've seen the proposals, at least in front of the commission, replacement windows, it's a whole unit. So I'm just curious, like how frequent have you seen that in real practice?
Well, when someone hits a baseball through a window, that's how they do it. So.
Oh, right, right. But I mean, like, you know, the whole program gets replaced or something.
I mean, I don't see why the frames would be replaced at all. I don't see that. If they're well maintained, why would we?
Right, but they only have a life of 20 to 30 years.
The glass.
Thermopane seals only last that long.
Right.
What Nate's saying is generally done. You take the sash out, you replace the sash.
Right. It's the whole sash.
Yeah.
Well, there's this frame, and then the sash goes into it.
Right. Take it out, put the glass in, put it back in. Right. It's pretty easy, actually, with these windows. I mean, they click right out. Hmm.
Any other commissioners?
I have just one question about the trends or whatever in the windows. I know that, Nate, since you're involved in other projects or in the industry, do you see any companies potentially making these casement windows to replicate the different planes that Stuart was talking about? I mean, we saw that trend just in replacement double hungs and the muttons and, you know, doing things to replicate the depth of the muttons. It doesn't seem like it would be that hard to create a casement that at least gives the appearance of, you know, using the depth of the planes also.
Well, the glass is one plane. So, I mean, the thickness of the material applied might thicken up or something. I think the big change coming is going to be triple glazing, getting way more efficient and inexpensive. All the screens we're staring at and all the big screens, there's a lot of high volume, thin glass that's really lightweight. And they keep saying it's coming. So I kind of think it is, but it's getting kind of old hearing it. But I do believe that triple glazing, because right now it's about 50% more, you know, hey, another pane of glass, and it weighs a lot more and it's way thicker. And I think that that's going to get thinner and lighter and cheaper soon. But that's probably the only thing I'm seeing right now.
You're talking about vacuum glass that's coming out of Japan?
Not so much that, but just the fact that, like, the glass itself, they're making it so thin because of these big screen TVs. Like, they're so lightweight. You know, if you ever saw one of the old ones, I bought one of the original ones, it weighed like unbelievable amount, and now they barely weigh anything. And that's partially because of the glass thickness, and because they're making it at such volume now, that's going to transfer to the window companies.
We probably best move on. Stuart, you want to make your motion?
Yeah, Kate, can you put the stuff up? Yes, I move that we grant a certificate of appropriateness to 1233 Judson Avenue, 21 Prez 0135, apartment building in Lakeshore Historic District. The certificate of occupancy to appropriateness to replace existing windows, add a 40 panel solar array to the south roof face, and construct a roof deck over the southeast flat roof with new stair rail access at the south face of the rear volume. Applicable standards, alteration 1 through 10, construction 1 through 8, and 10 through 14.
You know, this wasn't really updated to provide for of restoration of the windows.
Yeah.
I would just say that it should be your motion should include that it's just the project be developed in substantial compliance with the documents on record. So that would show that the primary elevations would retain their existing windows.
Okay, can Kate just amend my motion? to that effect.
Sure.
And it's also to rebuild the all of the front facing original windows.
Okay, a second.
Second.
Okay. Roll call vote. Commissioner Reinhold.
Aye.
Commissioner Sullivan.
Aye.
Commissioner Cohen.
Aye.
Commissioner Jacobs.
Aye.
Commissioner Bodin.
Aye.
Commissioner Dreller.
Aye.
And I'm an aye. So thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Our first meeting, our new business is 1414 Church Street. And just to clarify, so there's really two pieces to this that we have to, we have an opportunity to vote on. So the first piece that we're all more familiar with is we're asked to issue a certificate of appropriateness for basically demolition of the old garage and construction of a new garage. Additionally, the project requires a major zoning variance, which it will be heard by the Zoning Board of Appeals. We do not make the determination as to the zoning issues. What we are given the opportunity to, if we wish to, is to make a recommendation. I think, you know, from a preservation point of view, if we feel that you know, we wish to recommend for or against the zoning change. But again, you know, and I think this is important for everybody who's coming to speak on this matter tonight. We do not make the zoning determination. We are simply allowed to have input from a preservation point of view only if we decide there are preservation related issues. You know, we're not, you know, either empowered or necessarily qualified to make, you know, strictly zoning determinations. And so, you know, we won't be making those tonight. So I'd ask the applicant to introduce themselves and present their application.
Okay, hi. My name is Dan Tornheim. I'm the architect on the project. Let me go through the presentation. So Kate, do you have the drawing up so folks can see it? I guess.
I do have it up, Dan, unless you would like to share your screen.
No, it's okay. It's too fussy for me to share things. It looks good. If you could, Cade, can you go to like the sheet? It's titled HP-1.2. It shows the two site plans. Because I'm just gonna, I think it's the third sheet. Yeah, thanks. Okay, so the proposal for this project, Corey and Patty King came to me. They're the owners of the property of the house, and they came to me with the idea of trying to add a two-car garage to the property. And also improve the back portion of the house that has, it's got like a little mud room that's kind of attached. It's the southern wing of the house. You got a little mud room that's attached to the kitchen. It kind of blocks a lot of light and it needs improvement. So I was trying to find a way to best put a two-car garage on the property. But one of the biggest challenges with this property is that it's pretty small. It's a substandard lot size. It's, you know, it's a little over 4,700 square feet. And that kind of just throws a bunch of challenges at us in terms of setbacks and impervious surface and lot coverage. So we just tried to do our best. And I thought about where to put the garage on the property initially. But I didn't want to eat up a lot of yard space. You know, and the kids need yard space. Patty and Corey have a couple kids, so I want to maintain some yard space for families. I thought about potentially putting the garage, locating it kind of like in the northeast corner or northeast quadrant of the, but it's, there's not enough space between the house and the property line. It's like under 18 feet. And I thought it'd be best to try to avoid like another curb cut off of Church Street or a curb cut off of Church Street. So it seemed like the best opportunity was to locate the garage closer to the alley. There's a gravel improved alley there that's on the west side of the property. And so I just did it. The idea was to take down the existing one car garage. It's kind of dilapidated. It's not very big anyways. It'll fit a Model T, but it won't fit a lot of other cars. So I proposed an attached two car garage. I'm taking over some of the space of the actual existing house. There's the mudroom in the back there that I'm eating into in order for the two-car garage to work. But it does help. I can get a 20 by 20, basically a 20 by 20 garage, which is about as minimal as I can do. I wanted to be attentive to, you know, circulation around the property. So I put a 3-foot setback on the southern end of the property, that I set back the garage 3 feet from the property line. And I pushed the garage to the alley as close as I thought I could do it so that I could reduce the amount of impervious surface that I'm eating up. And so that's where the garage I thought would be the best location for it. And so what I did, hey, Kate, if you want to like look at the, or scroll up to look at like the, yeah, that's a good view. So what I did with the structure is I did a gable structure, trying to emulate the gable structures that are already existing in the house. I matched the roof pitch to the existing roof pitch, which is a 9-12 roof pitch. The overhangs of the garage match or are similar to the overhangs that are on the front porch of the existing house. There's a 2-foot overhang on the front porch. We just matched that same overhang for the garage. The rake board detail is like a latticed kind of rake board that's emulated and taken from the existing house structure or designed after that, so it kind of matches. And as far as materials, I'm just suggesting that we use cedar shingles, just like the existing house, and try to work in some of the same details in terms of, you know, the window, maybe a window style. So I did a triple window, which is similar to it. You can't see it in this view, but there's a triple window on the upper story of the gable on the east side of the house, similar to what we're doing in the garage here. So I'm trying to emulate as many possible details as I can to try to help kind of bring this a new addition, you know, into the same style as the existing house. So that's basically our proposal. That's what we're looking to do.
All right, questions?
It has nothing to do with our deliberation, but I'm just wondering, in terms of the zoning, are you looking for relief from coverage, but do you also need zoning relief for the yard adjacent to the garage, between the garage and the other house?
Yeah, so Stuart, we're looking for relief on that rear yard setback because it's a 30-foot setback. And you know, Kate, if you want to scroll back down to like the plans or the site plans, there's a dashed line that kind of, I made a rectangle out of it that shows where the setbacks run through the house. And so I need some relief somewhere. it's fairly difficult to find a way to do any kind of work on this house other than maybe a couple little pieces on the east and west side. So yeah, it's challenging. I admit, I was like, I was thinking about, you know, if I do attach this garage to the south side of the house, we have to have some kind of circulation around the property. And I need to set this garage a certain distance away from the property line for life safety, because I need to keep it away from other structures. I started with 3 feet and I thought that would probably be pretty acceptable. I could also, you know, I could build the structure as a 3B construction. It's, you know, the house is a type 4 construction frame house, but I could do the garage, you know, in a 3B, which makes it a little bit more safe, or a 3A construction type, which is, you know, masonry, masonry exterior. You wouldn't see the masonry. It would just be a masonry, you know, fire block essentially. So I'm trying to make it a little bit, you know, thinking about making it safe, and trying to keep it from the property line. The challenge is the more I move away from the property line, the smaller the garage gets. And we're trying to stick with a 2-car garage. We're looking for that because, I mean, you know, to be honest, most everybody in the neighborhood has a 2-car garage. We're looking to at least bring our property up to some, you know, a neighborhood standard of some sort. But yeah, Stuart, you're right. It's, you know, we're we're looking for a major variation on that rear yard setback.
Just to confirm, the agenda only describes that that the setback as the major zoning relief sought. Was there any other major zoning relief we have to vote on?
No, Mark, there's not. This triggers, I think, one other minor variation, which is a separate application by the applicant. And I think that was for building lot coverage.
Okay, so so we don't have to vote on that aspect.
No, I was aware of, Mark, I was aware of that. I just was curious for my own, wondering whether, that's a rear, the garage is in the rear yard.
Yeah.
And the problem obviously is the minute it's attached, it can't be in the rear yard.
Yeah. And Stuart, I thought about if there were a detached garage, like if you put it in this in the southeast corner, it feels like I'm eating up so much of the yard space that you know, there's not really a ton of room for kids to play and for the family to enjoy it. And I also thought maybe the southwest corner wouldn't be that great considering the east neighbor. It's, you know, that structure would be that much closer to the east neighbor. So I don't know. That was,
From a planning point of view, given the expense of doing something like this, the garage is where you want it to be in relation to the kitchen and getting into the house. So, you know, you should go for it. Do you have in your presentation a picture of the front of the house and the porch that looks like it has a hip roof?
Gosh, you know, I don't know if it's in this presentation. I suppose I could share my screen. Let me find. I've got my pictures.
Worry about it.
Okay, no worries. Sorry. Yeah. I have pictures. I can always send that to the commission, you know, or offline or whatever if you guys want to see it. I've got a bunch of pictures of the front. It's very, like Stuart, it's very similar. Like the rake board is very similar. It's almost exactly the same as what you see on the presentation. I try to emulate the details as best I could, just to, so it brings it back to the same nature of the house.
The front of the dormer, Stuart, has a very large shed dormer that was added, I think, in the late 1950s. There's a lot of pretty significant alterations to the home at that time.
Kate, there's a picture of it on page 77 of your packet.
There.
Oh yeah, I guess there is. Yeah, you're right.
That's the other facade.
Huh. Okay, thanks.
Why don't we at this point give members of the public who wish to speak an opportunity to, and then we can come back to anything commissioners wish to say. Was there a, I know we received some letters and emails which have been distributed, we have read, so I don't think they need to, you know, you don't need to repeat them. But Kate, is there a list of people signed up who wish to speak?
I think the property owner to the east of Amanda planned to, I think maybe address some separate concerns, or she might have questions, but she didn't intend to speak.
Okay, so I don't know if Amanda, do you wish to speak?
Yeah, I'd love to.
If you could just state your name first, and then if you could keep it to 2 minutes, we'd appreciate it. Thank you.
No problem. My name is Amanda Zeem. I live at 1632 Wesley Avenue. I live just east of the 1414 Church Street. We also own the coach house that this is, that the garage would be abutting up to. And one of the things I just wanted to call out, if Kate, I don't know if you can show the picture, the 3D image of the coach house next to the new garage that's proposed. And then I just wanted to call out the coach house in this pic, so the top picture, it just shows, it looks like it's a brick box basically with one door and a stairway. That's definitely not accurate. It's misrepresenting, I think, the historical nature of the coach house. And so maybe we can I did submit some pictures too. I don't know, Kate, if you have those of what it looks like from the back, or we do if you don't have it.
I can pull them up for you if you'd like. Yeah. I also circulated those.
Thank you.
So let me pull them up really quick.
Thanks. So the coach house is, our house is built in 1867, one of the oldest houses. The coach house also is over 100 years old. And historic in its own right. We also have tenants, and I did include this, but it's worth mentioning again, we do have tenants in there, and this really would impact, you know, their sight lines and the light, et cetera. And I don't know in any other circumstance if we'd ever consider putting another structure 3 feet from someone's front door, like we are here. Like, it's literally, there's almost zero setback now. And 3 feet is proposed, and then the eaves overhang such that it's going to be right at the coach house. And I just, like I said, I don't see any other. We would never consider putting a, you know, no one would ever build something 3 feet from any of these other houses. And it is a house, and it should be treated like that. Okay, yeah, okay, great. And here's the picture of the coach house. As you can see, this is not what it looks like in the rendering. So I just wanted to not to get lost that there are two balconies pretty much there, two landings, that the overhang there, the archways, that's not at all shown. And that would be, especially the first one, would be very, very much blocked. There's windows on that side that would be affected too. That's not represented in those renderings that were submitted for this project. And I just wanted to call that out. And then a couple more things. I just wanted to call out what Cade wrote in his staff report, which I thought was worth sort of mentioning too, is non-conforming lots are not atypical to Evanston, not atypical to this area. And I don't know if that in and of itself is a hardship, especially given that the owners bought this property and it was with the same lot size and zoning as it was when they purchased. There weren't changes made. So these were all kind of, you know, challenges that they would have been aware of, you know, upon purchasing this property. And then lastly, I just wanted to mention the new rules, as far as I understand them, around ADUs, because Evanston, as far as I know, is promoting ADUs. We have, obviously, our coach house is a historic ADU that's already been around forever. That the principal structures and garages need, you know, they need to be 10 feet away, ADUs. And this is clearly 3 feet is not, you know, what's considered acceptable for ADUs on if they were the same lot. So I think 3 feet is just, and it's not even 3 feet with the overhang, it's just way too close to that coach house. And that's all. Did you have anything to say, Kirk?
Nothing more to say.
Okay. So I am concerned about, like I said, the distance and the fire safety. I just think 3 feet is very tight.
I actually have one more comment. This is Kirk Zeem, Amanda's husband. The historic nature of the coach house, you can see, if you could go back to that rendering really quick, the 3D rendering. Kate, if you wouldn't mind. Yeah, thank you. You can see how much higher that rendering is of the new structure below. And it literally renders the north face of that coach house with the beautiful face of those windows and door openings as essentially looking at a, you know, looking at shingles. And right today there is a view there. So that kind of goes away. And that's something that, you know, in addition to the light and the kind of things you get from that additional space that goes in, flows in through the windows, will be gone or definitely impaired.
Yeah, and just one other item, the coach house can be viewed from some of these other angles as well, not just the view that they show from the alley. You can, if you look at the plat, like the lot, you can see our coach house very clearly from Wesley Avenue. It's not like you can only see it from this back angle. That's just not the case. You can also see it a bit from church because we have our driveway there. So some of it can be viewed from there as well.
Were there others who wish to speak? Now, I'd like to ask Dan if we could go on to, I think it's the next or two slides with the next page with the just a couple of questions. What's the, you know, including the eaves on the new garage, what's the difference in distance from the lot line of the old garage and the, you know, the full new garage, including the eaves?
Yeah, the plat survey shows that the existing one car garage is, I think it's like 0.77 feet from the property line. And it's represented in that site plan drawing I have on the left-hand side of this sheet. So it's like under a foot, the existing one car garage. And so our proposal is to put our new garage 3 feet away. The overhangs are just, like I said, I matched them based on what the existing house has, which they're 2 foot overhangs. So in theory, we're still, even the overhangs are further away than from the property line than the existing one car garage.
So with the overhangs, there's only about a foot left to the property line?
There's 1 foot, yeah.
And do you know the proximity of the neighboring coach house to the lot line?
You know, I just eyeballed it. I don't have a plat of survey, so I don't have anything, you know, professionally accurate. The stair looks like it's right on the property line. So it's tricky. You know, I think about life safety a lot when I do my projects, and this neighboring property has an exit stair that's directly on the property line. So I was like, you know, I need to set my new addition away from that. And, you know, I look at these and I study the same types of properties I work, you know, when I do stuff in the city of Chicago. We look at the IBC and the city of Chicago zoning codes, and there's plenty of structures that are 3 feet from each, you know, property line, or sometimes they're only 3 feet apart. I don't want it to be as close as I don't want to try to make it really close. I wanted to try to set it back a little bit, and at least 3 feet, and try to make the garage structure, like a 3A or 3B structure to make it a little bit more fire safe. But the fact remains that the existing structure on the neighboring property has an exit stair right on our property line from what it looks like. I don't know if you can see it in any of the pictures or not, but it's right on it.
Yeah, I just wanted to say the difference is this is a residence. Like, to have it just so close to a residence, this isn't another garage. And it's also not the city of Chicago. We have our own zoning for this reason. So I just wanted to mention that.
Thanks.
Yeah, Mark, if I can just clarify, I think from the plat of survey that I could dig up, the foundation of the coach house to the south is about a little over 2 feet from the lot line, but then it has those two kind of canted balconies which do extend to the lot line.
Well, in the stairway.
And yeah, correct, in the stairway. Mm-hmm.
Is there any other discussion by commissioners?
Yeah, I mean, there is no way to solve the client's program for a two-car garage. So the only way to relieve the situation would be if the client was willing to apply for and have a garage that looked like this, but was in fact not a full two-car garage, perhaps a one-and-a-half-car garage. And then you'd back it away from the adjacent house and the lot line. On the other hand, I don't see a good solution for this. And I think that in terms of our charge, we're supposed to make a determination about whether or not we think the work and the design that we've been presented is compatible with the existing structure. Not is it creating a really horrible and difficult condition with the adjacent house, which is also non-conforming.
Yeah, I thought your I just have a clarification. I thought you guys also make a recommendation on the major variance, which is the setback. So that concerns the setback.
We are allowed to make a recommendation from a preservation point of view. And we've yet to discuss whether commissioners feel that there is a preservation angle to that. We haven't gotten to that part of the proceeding yet.
Got it. And then I understand you look at the design, but also do you consider, I was under the, from my research, my understanding was that you also considered the historical like nature of the whole district and other structures, not just the one that is being proposed.
Yes, that's definitely right.
Okay, so I guess my understanding was that would be you do need to think about the impact on the historical coach house that is, you know, right next to the proposed garage.
Right. I mean that's right.
Okay.
All right. So before we try to parcel out how we might vote and whether we do two motions, is there any other just general discussion by commissioners?
Mark, I don't know, and Kate, I don't know if this was brought forth, but I'd love to see an outline of the old garage sitting in front of the new proposed garage to really get a great feel for the massing and the before and after. I mean, they're sitting there right on top of each other on the sheet, and yet I still can't quite tell how much more of an intrusion potentially the new garage is.
You guys want me to share my screen? I could try to pull up on my drawing. I can overlay the two.
That'd be great. Help.
Okay, gotta give me a second to try to figure out how to do it. Got a couple of technical things to map out here. Let me share this.
While Dan's doing that, I just have a quick comment. I mean, the height of the garage is only about 16 and a half feet, 16.8 feet, which I don't think is, as far as the standards and everything, I don't think that's excessive for a garage. I guess my question would be is, as a commission, do the 2-foot eaves have to exist? Whereas I do appreciate that they're trying to mimic the historic features, I think it does pose the effect that it does get closer to the historic coach house. So I guess that would be one question I'd want my fellow commissioners to maybe think about. I mean, I do appreciate that the slope of the roofs match and that everything is very similar. And then in my opinion, that all makes sense. But maybe the eaves could be a topic of discussion to help minimize the encroachment onto the adjacent property.
Now, I was just gonna quickly mention, like, we're not opposed to adjusting the eaves. I just didn't want to compromise the look of the new addition. I just was gonna try to make it as close to the existing house as I could as a starting point. I was thinking about, when we were talking about this, well, would we change the eave dimension and how would that affect things? I don't know. I'd have to, study it. And I'm not super thrilled about the idea of lowering the roof pitch I just don't like odd roof pitches, in a house that you could easily accommodate the standard roof pitch. So, I mean, it's possible to lower it, but it'll definitely deviate from what's existing. I did pull up my drawing that shows. You can see in red, this is the old garage. And then the new garage, which is I'm trying to highlight here. And this is the old garage is, distance wise, it's 0.77 feet from the property line or 1.1 foot 4 inches and some change.
Dan, do you have the alley side elevation with them superimposed over each other?
Yeah, I could do that.
That's what I was really hoping to see.
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah.
Before you leave this drawing, I was waiting for the eaves. Do you have the eaves on there?
The eaves don't show up in this one. It's a planned view, so it just kind of cuts through the walls, but you might be able to see it pretty easily if I show you the elevation, because that'll show you the dimension. I mean, it won't show you the dimension, but it'll show you the profile. So let me see if I could, let me scroll through this and see what I can show you guys. So that's the west. That's the west. Okay, let me put the old garage on there. Sorry. So that's kind of, yeah, I mean, it's basically how it works out. You can see the existing house and the garage is kind of hidden by the new addition, but this is a wall in red of the old garage. And, you know, and then the new garage, you know, the eaves don't really, I mean, they're not that much higher at all. And in fact, the peak of the garage isn't really that far distant from the existing gable peak of the existing house. So,
wow,
they're close. They're pretty close.
Is there any way you can pull that old one in front of the new one?
Let me see what I can do.
While he's doing that, can I make a comment as well? This is Kirk again. It looks like the roof or the roof on the coach house isn't depicted as it actually is. It actually extends further out to the south or to the north.
A few feet, at least.
It might even over. I mean, I don't know if it would overhang over the right, south lip of the garage, but it would be pretty darn close. Mm-hmm. So I don't think the elevation on the coach house isn't correctly depicted. I just want to share.
Yeah, I didn't. I mean, I didn't go on the property and measure the coach house. I did my best, and it was, you know, just I wanted to make sure I put a structure there and put the stair there so that we could at least see relationship between the two properties. So I don't know. Yeah, did my best though, but I'd have to kind of measure all of that stuff up and get all the details on it.
So is the red outline that disappears behind the garage door actually the one car garage that's there?
Yeah, Stuart, that's the one-car garage. Yeah.
The new structure is significantly more massive than the one-car garage, but, you know, we sort of understood that.
Yeah.
Dan, my compliments. The graphics and the way you're manipulating them really makes certain things very clear.
Okay, I'm glad. It's you know, the new technology, right? It's kind of... it's helpful. It's hard to do, but it does help me too. So I appreciate you mentioning that.
If I could just make one other comment too, the pitch of the red roof there that's connected to the existing house is sort of angled up this way. The other one is an entire wall face of the garage that faces the north side of the coach house. That's what I was talking about before around the lighting and just the kind of feel of it from the north face of the coach house windows and doors. With windows.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I drew the existing one car garage as best I could. Yeah. I mean, if you guys want to see what the windows, I didn't get a chance to measure the coach house to the south of us. I didn't get into that effort. I was more looking at trying to get the right details on the proposed addition. So.
I have a question just about kind of what our purview from preservation is versus what the zoning will be looking at. One of the things whenever I see these big eaves is that it just makes me worried about the snow and where the snow drops off. You know, I see gutters for the rain, so that would be helpful. But, you know, if we get another snow like we had this last winter, then all that snow is just dropping right onto those stairs. Is that more of a zoning issue to be concerned about that, or are we concerned about that? I'm just not sure kind of what where that line is for what we're looking at tonight.
Well, our preservation code doesn't have any elucidation of what we're supposed to look at. I mean, I think, you know, it's part of the powers of furthering the powers of the Preservation Commission. And so I don't know. I mean, I think we could separate the two, but you know, they're not 100% separable and there's no exact rules of what we have to do.
And the new design for the two car garage, the line of the coach house is 3 feet away from the line of not this, is it 3 feet away from the stairs of the adjacent existing coach house, or is it 3 feet away from the wall of the coach house?
It's a property setback line. It's 3 feet from the property setback line.
Okay.
From the property, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you could probably throw a dimension on, like if you've measured between like the existing one car garage and the coach house, that might give you some idea of like the distance between between structures. But the reality is that the stair, like even, I know it's not this, the existing property isn't super accurate, but the stair is accurately shown like right on the, it is right on the property line. So it's that the, you know, the existing one car garage is closer than our proposed new two car garage. The eave, you're right, the eave does overhang a little bit. And I mean, I would entertain potentially like scaling down the depth of the eave. Maybe we can go to like a foot or something like that. Maybe it wouldn't really affect the aesthetics of the new addition. It's a deviation from what's existing, but it probably will look still look just fine. And that will give us, you know, a little bit of room. And you know, your question about, you know, what happens with snow, and it's even worse now with the one car garage, right? It's like, you know, it's less than a foot away from the property line. So if we do bring the eave back a little bit, maybe about a foot, it would still, that would be an improvement on the distance between the two structures.
If I could chime in, it's hard to compare the amount of snow that you could get off a roof that size versus the smaller one. It's no comparison. It's way more.
Yeah, that's right.
And what you would do to one eave, would you keep it symmetrical on the other side too?
Yeah, I would scale them both back so there's some symmetry, and you know, yeah, the scales are the same. I think you could still keep the rake detail the same. It just scales it back, and it doesn't change the rake detail. It's still the same lattice work. It just doesn't overhang as much. Yeah, and maybe it would help. Yeah,
I think it'd be helpful to see some of these renderings with an accurate rendering of the coach house too, because we're looking at something that is incorrect. It's hard to see the roof line and how it impacts the windows because they're not in any of the drawings.
And the true overhang in the coach house.
And the overhang isn't right.
I'll jump in here. I need to remind members of the public that public comment is a defined period of time, and we need to allow the commissioners to be able to deliberate and ask questions without interruption.
Okay. Yeah. And I think we've had a good discussion and actually appreciate all the suggestions made. From the commissioner's point of view, we've got a few alternatives. I guess, you know, one alternative would be to vote first on the certificate of appropriateness and then discuss the zoning issue. And if we wanted to, we could include in the motion, you know, we're trying not to continue it. We could, if we wanted not to continue, we could include a request that the, a slightly modified design to reduce the size of these be brought back for a kind of administrative review in consultation with a couple commissioners. I mean, would that appeal to the commissioners?
Would appeal to me, and I would then want to get Dan's opinion on whether or not he would also be willing to bring the entire roof eave line down vertically. I'm not saying much, but if there's any room to spare, would that mess up the cross connection piece roof pitch if the garage roof came down?
Yeah, that's well, I was thinking about that, like, oh, maybe I could bring the roof pitch of the whole gable down closer to the ground. But the challenge is the connector I don't have that kind of ceiling height to work with. I'm going to start cutting, you know, corners into the new kitchen and the new structure that's part of the interior of the house. Like the garage isn't too bad because it's stepped down by like 4 feet or 3.5 feet or something. So there's no head height issues in the garage if you bring the gable down, but I have to bring the gable connector down, which impacts the head height. I'm matching like this gable connectors, the head height just matches the existing house. If I bring it down, it'll cut corners out of the, you know, the top of the ceiling. So I'm trying to avoid that if possible. And maybe, maybe if you guys want to see a roof pitch change, I'm worried about that idea.
I think we strive to match the roof pitch. Sorry, Stuart, I didn't mean to jump in. I think half the time we're fighting to have applicants match roof pitches of contributing structures. So in my opinion, I actually appreciate that they're the same pitch. I don't think the minor change is going to really make a huge impact on the adjacent structures in the way that I think everybody wants it to. So my two cents would be that I would leave the roof pitch matching the home.
Okay. Yeah.
I would agree. Hey, Kate, is there any way we can see the architectural floor plan of the garage and the adjacent kitchen again?
Yeah, I can pull that up. Here, let me...
Do I have to stop my share?
I'll do it. Yeah, there we go. Thanks.
Or Dan could have.
I guess I could have. Sorry about that. Yeah, yeah. This is the same thing.
So is that an existing kitchen or are you remodeling the kitchen?
Yeah, I'm remodeling the kitchen. And, you know, Kate, in your presentation, you don't have the existing, but I can show that to you guys. I can share that with you. And you can see what the existing looks like compared to the new.
Oh, to move the garage over, you would have to actually steal space from the kitchen.
Right.
Which would involve rebuilding the section of roof over it. And it wasn't clear to me whether you're doing that already or not.
There's that's a good question, Stuart. I think we're tying into a portion of the existing roof. We're not rebuilding the entire thing. And my client and I were talking about, what do you do if we try to move this garage further north and it just impacts the kitchen a lot? Not that it's the worst thing, but it's tight. Like the garage is already a 20-foot exterior dimension.
Can you go back to the plan again? We have up before. So I don't know. I assume that you've got, it looks like you've got 4 feet between the island and the counters on either side.
I think I'm pretty sure about this. I think I did 42 inches because it's just so tight. Let me look. I'll just throw a dimension on my drawing right now just to make sure I'm not speaking out of turn.
No, it's, I mean,
3'6" between the island and the range, which is about as minimal.
You don't want less than that.
Nope, I know.
I don't think we should get into the kitchen design other than the, I mean, I think we can see that.
So, lack of space. The dilemma I see is that if we're asked to vote on whether or not the thing is compatible with the existing house, then I think, clearly Dan's done a nice job of doing that. If we're asked to recommend the zoning, clearly if we have a problem with the positioning of the new garage with respect to the lot line and to the existing coach house, and we don't approve that, then we've wasted everybody's time because chances are he won't get through zoning with it, in which case the whole project doesn't work.
All right. Well, it has to come before us for Preservation Commission before the zoning determination can be made. So why don't we try to divide this into two pieces and vote first on the certificate of appropriateness and then decide what we want to do on the zoning issue. And then it sounds like the commissioners were, was reading the nodding of the heads correctly, were willing to vote on a motion to approve that was subject to Dan coming back for a couple of commissioners to look at administratively the potentially reducing the size of the eaves to increase the distance between the eaves and the coach house. If that's okay, if somebody could make a motion on just the certificate of appropriateness. I mean, Susie, do you want to make a motion?
Yeah, I can do it. So I move to issue a certificate of appropriateness for 1414 Church Street, case number 21-PRES-0153, to demolish the existing single-car garage, detached single-car garage, and construct a new attached two-car garage with alley access at the rear volume of the residence. That would include the applicant to review the existing proposed eave construction and provide modifications to reduce the eave size and encroachment on the adjacent property with administrative review and possibly a subcommittee of commissioners. The
You're muted.
Sorry. Applicable standards include 1 through 5, demolition 1 through 5, construction 1 through 4, 7 through 8, and 10 through 15.
A second?
Second.
Okay, a roll call vote on that motion. Commissioner Reinhold.
Aye.
Commissioner Sullivan.
Aye.
Commissioner Cohen.
Aye.
Commissioner Jacobs.
Aye.
Commissioner Baudin.
Aye.
Commissioner Dreller.
Aye.
And I'm an aye. All right, so on the zoning, I mean, Kate, I don't know if you have an opinion on this, but it seems like we could, either vote to recommend the zoning change or, I think if we wish to, we could decide it's not a preservation matter at all and therefore simply state that because we think the zoning matter not a preservation, the preservation issues aren't the main issues that we're not making a recommendation. Do you think that would be permitted? Two permitted choices?
I don't know if that's been done before. I know that there are committees that provide a recommendation of no recommendation. I can double check the ordinance. I think it says that you shall provide a recommendation. I guess if I interpret that, it should probably be for or against. But I don't know if that's been done before. I know Carlos is on the call. I don't know if there's a precedent for that.
I don't recall that any precedent of that nature where there's no recommendation.
You could provide a recommendation with conditional on, positive recommendation on the condition that the eaves are reduced or something similar.
Correct.
I mean, the problem is if we decide that there aren't that the issues are not preservation issues at all within our purview, but they're strictly, it's the proximity of a structure to a lot line. It's nothing to do with whether it's an historic district or a landmark. It's the, simply what setbacks do under the zoning code.
Can we make a recommendation, Mark, that only applies to, we define what we think it applies to as far as preservation? Is there a way to do something like that so that we clearly state what aspect of the recommendation we're making?
I mean, I agree with Mark's statement of the quandary we're in, because whenever we make these types of recommendations, I also think of them as relative to, the historic nature of the property and our standards and, thus as a preservation, I feel for some of the quandaries that, and the problems and questions that have been brought up by the neighbors and everybody, but under our standards and because of walking the neighborhood and the alley and looking at all the structures around there from a preservation perspective and our standards, I don't see how I could make a make a recommendation on zoning because things are, you know, there's a lot of variety around there. And so I don't see how we could say that and stay within our standards and our purview. I really do think the issues of safety, you know, and zoning and whatever and lot lines are for the zoning committee and other departments in the city to deal with.
Yeah. It seems to me we had a similar case a while back where we were at where there was a garage structure that they wanted to turn into an ADA by putting a second floor on it. And the building immediately, I think it was to the north, was non-conforming and it was built right to the lot line. And even though the garage, second floor garage addition was conforming with respect to the setback, it would have been, because of the non-conforming condition, so close that it totally blocked windows in an adjacent dwelling unit. And in that case, we decided that, you know, that we couldn't do anything about it. It wasn't an issue. So I personally would go with Mark saying that we're not making a determination because we don't think it's a preservation related issue.
Yeah, Mark, I just read the ordinance. It says to review applications and make advisory recommendations. So I think that you're correct. I think the intent largely is to just give them a preservation perspective on some of these issues. And I think it was well stated that there's a lot of variety here. It's not that the predominant condition on the block is that accessory structures are, you know, 3 feet away from each other or something. So I think you would be well within your powers to basically just say that you don't have any advisory recommendations on it.
We can like decline to advise, something like that.
What was that? Sorry.
We can decline to advise. Can we vote on that?
Yeah, I think you could just, I mean, it could just say that you didn't have any recommendations on the proposed zoning relief, and I think that's okay.
I think we should expressly state that we believe that the issues involved in the zoning variance are zoning issues, not preservation issues, and therefore we decline to advise. So they understand why we are taking a position.
I agree. I think it is kind of a unique circumstance compared to when this has come up before.
As a chair, Mark, can you make that does it have to be a motion or is it, how does this work, Kate?
I don't think it has to be. I think if you were saying that you were gonna recommend a positive or negative recommendation, there would need to be general support behind that as the voice of the commission. But if nobody has any recommendations, I don't think there needs to be a formal motion.
Okay, so we'll just say in the record that the commission declined to make a recommendation for or against the zoning variance because they felt the issues involved were zoning issues and not preservation issues.
Are the other commissioners in agreement?
Yes.
Hey, you sure, Mark? You don't want me to try to just reiterate that and we vote on it? It's up to you guys. No? Okay.
It's also just all for Dan, I'll just let you know that the proposed changes with the eaves, that won't impact the notice that went out for the zoning board. So you'll still make your meeting date, which I think is next Tuesday.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. Yeah, thanks, okay. Kate. Mm-hmm.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. All right, the next matter is 2121 Sheridan Road, landmark 21 Prez 0156. Is the applicant here to speak?
Yes, my name is John Lampkin, President of Lampkin Enterprises Construction. We're the general contractor on the project. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you fine. If you'd like to present your application, please.
Yeah, you know, apologize, Rico Ramos, who's our architect, REM Architecture, he's out of the country at the moment and wasn't able to join this meeting. But hopefully I can narrate this and tell you where we're at with this project. So Garrett, I'm sure everybody's familiar with Garrett. They are proposing to add a wheelchair ramp, an accessible ramp, to the front of the main entrance of the building, the main building. Kate, if you could go to the next page down, if you don't mind. There we are. This is a 3D rendering of the wheelchair ramp that we're proposing. The wheelchair ramp will be made of concrete. We'll be doing a new railing to complement some of the new railings that the college has put in place. The existing building itself is made of limestone. The existing stairway there is concrete, and so are the walkways. So the ramp will be made of concrete. We're putting it on the south wall, running along the south wall there. Our intent was to blend it in as best we could. I think that we've accomplished that. There's very minimal of the existing structure that has to be demolitioned in order to do this. There's really no other, you know, Garrett's intent on this location was because this is the main entrance to the building as well, as opposed to putting the ramp into a different location of the building. It didn't make any sense, and there was nothing that that would work, in their opinion, for people that need to come into the main entrance and for school or so on and so forth, take care of, you know, any of the business that the school attends to. I don't know if there's any questions I could answer.
Yeah, I have a question. The ramp, is it touching the adjacent building next to it, or it looks like it might be a couple feet away from the building that it runs parallel along?
Right. Yes, good question. Give me 1 second here. I'll see if.
Yeah.
Okay. Kate, I think it's page like 4 or 5 down. It's A1 A11.
I think it should be this one, John. I think I'm on.
Oh, there we are. Yes, there we are, Kate. Yeah. So it seems to be, what do we have? There's a couple of feet in between. And what we're going to do here, it hasn't actually been expressed really from the college what we're going to be doing. There's an existing drain right in line with those steps. You see there's a circle and it says new drain.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an existing drain there. What we're going to do is, our proposal was to fill it up and, you know, fill it up with stone or even concrete, we're thinking. Not all the way up to the height of the ramp, but to the height of the existing drain. What we're going to do then is put in a trench drain, they call it, which is 8 inches wide by going, you know, the desired length. And then what this will do is any of the rainwater coming off the building, the downspouts will be tied into this and run off toward the grass area, what would that be, the west or the lower part of the ramp, for say. We don't want to drill any drain holes going through the ramp. That's something that the school was asking us to do, but it's against my better judgment to do that, because you get rodents that collect in there, you get leaves and debris and such, that it clogs up that you know, that drain hole going through the bottom of the ramp.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the trench drain would be a much better solution.
Okay. Yeah, so, my main concern was just, you know, in those pockets in between each of the and the parts that jut out there, then just making sure that water moisture wasn't going to start impacting the, you know, the limestone building, or offer opportunities for the water to puddle up or the snow to collect, or just what was your water mitigation strategy for that?
Right, right.
Potential problem area.
Right, right. The trench drain would, or let me say one more thing. The second proposed idea we have with the school is that the drain will remain where it's at, and then we're going to pitch concrete in that area over to the drain. Everything will go into the drain and then run out. We're going to run it out underground, like to a landscape drain, and come up underneath the ramp, and it'll come out into the lawn area. Kind of like what they do with homes with downspouts.
Yeah, right,
right. So this will take care of, you know, water did carve the Grand Canyon, so we certainly don't want to start carving the limestone of the building. You know, right. Water is can cause a lot of damage, as we know. So, where those embankments are coming out of the limestone, as you see in the drawing here, we're going to have it so as the water is there, it will run around those embankments, yeah, and then go toward, be pitched toward the drain or trench drain. The trench drain will be the same style. It just will be longer, not just one round, you know, 6-inch round drain.
Hmm. Okay. And then just one other question was, it looks like you're not changing anything having to do with the drop-off, the grassed area around the circular drop-off, you know, the circular drive and the drop-off. I was just right. wondering if that might be part of the plan to make the drop-off area for the person using the ramp closer to the entrance to the ramp.
You know, no, there's nothing been proposed about that. According to Garrett, Evanston, it's somewhere back in the, I don't know what, where it worked out at, but according to Garrett, 70 years ago or somewhere around there, that road was owned by Garrett. Mm-hmm. And now it is owned by the city of Evanston. Mm-hmm. So there has been no talk about moving that road, you know, that circular drive.
I just meant like opening up the grass area and, you know, just, you know, making it so the person could get off out of their car and like, yeah, right. Exactly.
Well, that area. Yeah. Oh, good. That hasn't been talked about. Where, as you see, right, what has been talked about is you see the bottom of the ramp there, yeah, how it kind of 90 degrees to the right. That's the existing sidewalk as it is now. So a car would pull up past the grass area, mm-hmm, and they would have to wheel over to where the grass area ends. Yeah. Right. I guess we could, cutting across the lawn straight across. So when they make that 90 at the bottom of the ramp, they can go straight up across. That would be fine. And I don't think Garrett would be opposed to that.
Just an idea. I mean, just an idea, you know, just to provide that direct.
Sure. And you know, Garrett has been putting some new plants and vegetation in the front of the building there. And it has not been said what they would like to have along the landscape ramp. Give me one second. Kate, if you wouldn't mind, the second, page three, it's AO2. There we are. So it shows some vegetation. So the vegetation to the the front of the school, where you see those two people walking, that's pretty much how it looks now. And that's some new stuff that they have put in. The if you look at the bottom of the ramp, you'll see some bushes. Oh, that looks to be about 3 feet, 4 feet tall. That's existing bushes right now. The new bushes along the bottom of the ramp there, that's proposed. What we're proposing in our drawings. It's nothing that Garrett has said what they're putting. They want it, they will be doing some kind of vegetation to complement the front that they have redone already.
John, can you clarify something for me? I thought I heard you say that the existing steps and landings were concrete, but on that proposed site plan, they said that they're limestone.
You know, Kate, yeah, let's see here, which one? I think it's D2 page. Let me zoom in here.
Oh, it says remove.
Kate, you're right. We're both kind of right. The bottom section is concrete on those steps.
Okay, I see.
The upper steps and the top stoop, the top landing is limestone.
Okay.
Is what we have here. And okay. And if you look, on, are you on D2? Is that the where I'm at? Yes, D2. If you look at the lower photo, to the right, where mm-hmm. where that railing is kind of highlighted or darkened, that is what's going to be removed there. And there's a planter to the right of that will be removed. The rest of the steps and everything existing will remain. The only additional thing, let me say this, that we're going to change, the existing railings, the additional existing railings on these steps will be removed and replaced with the new railings to complement the ramp as well. You know, so everything looks even and new. If you give me one more, I'd like to say, just show you guys one more thing here. If you can bear with me, I'm trying to find my. If we can go one more up, D1, the page, I think it's before this one. Okay, there we are. So at the top, if you look at the landing on top, you'll see where it says remove limestone steps. We're just removing the edge there. The existing steps are kind of like angled, and that's where we're going to kind of saw cut it right there. So we're not kind of losing the symmetrical integrity of the existing staircase. You know, it's still going to look the same. We're not like redesigning the whole front entrance. We're trying to leave as much of the existing as possible, you know?
So the existing limestone landing is big enough has enough clearance for the top of the ramp, so you don't have to touch that.
Right. Well, we will be, if you look at that kind of like dotted line.
Yeah, you'll be taking out that stuff to get the ramp, but then it'll just feed into the existing.
Correct, Alicia. Yep, exactly.
Do you know the history of those steps? Because clearly that was all modified at some point. That's the only way to explain the fact that some of it's limestone and some of it's concrete.
Correct. I'm told the building is about 1840. Somewhere around there is what I was told by members of Garrett, the upper staff there. Those limestone steps, if they're not original, they're way up there in age, in my opinion. The lower steps at some time where, I mean, concrete was added down the line back then, you know?
Makes you wonder why somebody didn't try and face all of that with a limestone veneer, which would be nice on the ramp since it's really seen against the building behind it. Given how awkward I think that the curb and the planter is, and the fact that you're taking away the other planter, which was a symmetrical condition, I guess if you took that second planter away, you'd have to modify the concrete steps. It's, you know, too bad they didn't rip it all out and start again. If you want to see how beautifully something like that can be done, look at the new steps and the handicapped ramp and the development in front of the main library. It's really, you know, it's a superbly done an intervention on a really great historical building that I think I've ever seen.
Oh, no, I would agree. I would agree 100%.
Probably different budget too.
It was brought, I actually had brought up the idea of asking them while we were designing this if they wanted us to rip out all those concrete steps and put limestone, because we have the capability of doing that. It was told to me that the budget, even though I have the capability, they don't have the capability of doing that now. But that, I agree, that would be awesome.
Why don't we try to move on? Is there anything else you wanted to present before we do any discussion and a vote?
Myself? No, sir. No more.
Thank you. Just to make sure, was there any member of the public who wished to speak to this? No, thanks. Discussion by commissioners? Would someone like to make a motion to approve? Come on, one of you brave people who hasn't made a motion yet tonight.
I can do it.
Thank you.
I'll do it. Okay, I move to issue the certificate of appropriateness for the property at 2121 Sheridan Road, the landmark, case number 21-PRES-0156. To construct an accessible ramp at the front entrance of the Garrett Evangelical Theological Institute, adjacent to the south volume's north elevation. The applicable standards are alterations 1 through 10 and construction 6 through 7 and 10 through 14.
A second?
I'll second.
A roll call vote, Commissioner Reinhold?
Aye.
Commissioner Sullivan?
Aye.
Mr. Cohen?
Aye.
Mr. Jacobs?
Aye.
Mr. Bodin?
Aye.
Mr. Dreller?
Aye.
And I'm an aye. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for your time and enjoy your evening.
Thanks. Thank you. All right, so that concludes the matters before us. I guess we're gonna go into minutes and administrative stuff. We'd prefer if non-members of the commission or staff sign off, please. I don't know if Carl was staying on. Thanks. All right, Cade, up to you.
Two separate sets of minutes. I know that Stuart, you had some concerns about the two meetings ago, the September meeting. That video is still, I don't know if it's like corrupted or something. I can't really get anyone to give me any input. I did add some of your concerns into the minutes. We can hold it again, or we can. I can't get a good answer if the video is ever going to be available is the issue.
Yeah, but you sent the result of the administrative review to Schumacher Design, right?
Correct, yeah, and I'm waiting for a response.
I think we should just approve them.
Yeah. Second.
I move to approve the the meeting minutes. I move to approve the meeting minutes for September 14th, 2021.
Should we approve October 12th at the same time?
You know, I have to abstain from October 12th because I wasn't there. So yeah, it's up to you guys. Do you want me to do both?
We can move both and then not vote on October 12th.
Okay. I move to approve the meeting minutes for September 14th and October 12th, 2021.
A second. All right. A roll call vote, and you can specify what you have to abstain on. Commissioner Reinhold.
Aye for September 14th and abstain on October 12th.
Commissioner Sullivan.
I do the same. Aye for September, abstain for October because I wasn't there.
Commissioner Cohen.
I'll vote an aye for both.
Commissioner Jacobs.
Aye and aye.
Commissioner Bodan.
Aye and aye.
Commissioner Dreller.
Aye for both.
And I'm aye for both. So thank you.
Okay, and then next, I think, maybe, is Carlos still on? I'm not sure if he is.
Yeah, he's there.
Oh, he is. Okay. So next was an update on design guidelines, which I'll let Carlos speak to.
Thank you. So last month, we presented a memorandum to the commission with the request to have the participation of the commission to draft the design guidelines. And we have Stuart Cohen and Jamie agreed to help with that. So we had our first meeting actually this afternoon, and we went through the outline of the document. We had some comments about the content of the guidelines, which we will be presenting at the next meeting since we have not actually put together in the document itself, although I received Jamie's notes on and Stuart's suggestions with some modifications, such as moving some of the sections of the outline towards the front rather than in the back. For instance, they wanted to take in the guidelines for exterior maintenance and alteration section that we have and make it into a separate document. That was based on the experience that Jamie has drafting these type of documents. She felt that that would be another type of arduous work that is not necessarily part, shouldn't necessarily be part of the design guidelines. And also add the purpose, the statement of purpose to the new guidelines. So we will have a revised outline for you. And also we have agreed to meet again on November 30th to continue with the process of drafting the design guidelines.
May I say something here?
Of course.
I think the outline that we got was totally unclear as to why we need to draft design guidelines, and it was certainly so extensive that the design guidelines would have run an inordinate length, and it was unclear who the primary end users of such a document would be. My opinion is that it would be people seeking to come before this commission, and it would be people looking to buy a house that was either in a landmark district or a landmarked house and wanting to understand what exactly that meant. Having said that, we have a set of design guidelines already. It was the work of Jack Weiss, Elliot Dudnick, and Julie Hacker. They spent over 2 years doing this, meeting once a week to develop it. It went up on the site and was thrown away, literally, because it had embedded in it a series of links to all of the forms and all of the information that somebody would need if they were altering or requesting a certificate of appropriateness from this commission. And those aren't there as of now. So I need as a committee member to understand who the users are, what the purpose of doing this document is, and then whether or not we should do it from scratch, which is what the really extensive outline we received suggests, or whether we would be better served to go back and look at the guidelines that were developed by the three people that did it, who say they looked at guidelines from many municipalities and did research to do this, and then decide whether or not, A, we need to alter them, we need to expand them, and you know what we need to do to actually make them accessible to the end users, which the city seems to have never understood.
All right, so this is the reason why we have the members of the commission participating to highlight some of the points. No, it's okay, Stuart. I think there's a reasonable explanation to this. This document is not the same as this design guidance that were developed by the three former commissioners. In fact, I was involved with that. So one of the things that happened, the commission looked at these guidelines over a period of 2 years since 2017 until they were actually placed online on December of 2019, when they were actually online. And subsequent to that, the effort is now to actually develop the guidelines that will have different styles and the different ways of altering and putting new additions or new construction. And if you look at the document that the former commissioner just put together, and now it's called the procedural guidelines, because those are more procedurals to explain what it will take to get a certificate of appropriateness. And then that includes also the standards for review of alteration, construction, relocation, and demolition. So the idea here is that we're gonna use the guidelines to complement all of that, rather than just leaving up in the air what, you know, what guidelines do you use to meet the standards. And so this is the difference between that document and the one that we are preparing for the commission. And you're right, we need to be more clear as far as who are the users, who's the intended audience for this. It's not only the commission members, but also the public, the architects, the contractors, and even attorneys that represent their clients. So this document, the intent is to make it even clearer what the intention of the ordinance is in and how to achieve an approval from the commission. So the guidelines that you referred to, we have the document, and in the current website, there are sections of that document that are now being in different format, but that work has not gone away per se. It's not in the same form, but it's been used to develop what is now a current page, which is different from the one I was familiar with. Since I was away for some time. So this is also something that I needed to look into once the question was asked, what happened with those guidelines? So maybe, Kay, you can maybe give us a little bit more information about the current website and how that evolved.
Because right now you can click on, the link is procedural and design guidelines.
Correct.
Takes to.
Right, and it's not necessarily all the documentation that was submitted. In fact, some of the links are separated now, and they are there. It's just not in the same form.
Yeah, I can provide answers, I guess, to some of Stuart's comments first. I mean, the main user are residents, homeowners, contractors, and designers. I think the difference between primarily to me, I don't think the intent of this document and the intent of the document that was produced previously, I don't think that those conflict with each other. I think what we're trying to do is really provide more predictability in what the preferred treatment types are that would meet the standards. And I think what goes with that, that isn't included in the other document, are providing graphics, photo examples of what to do, what not to do. I think that the idea of having a visual document, I think that's very appealing, and seems to be really the standard that municipalities are setting today. And I think that the work that was done before, I would completely disagree with you when you say that the intent is to throw it away, because that's not true. It can either live independently or it should really be integrated into this document. It was a profound amount of work, and it was very good work. And I don't think anyone intends to redo that same work or duplicate efforts in any way. And then I'll speak to just, we were given direction, or I guess I specifically was given direction, that document, or the way it was outlined, it was really just on the Historic Preservation website. You had to scroll through it really continually to view all of that. And I was given direction that was not user friendly for somebody, and that in more cases, somebody is visiting that website to say, I just want to see the standards for review. I don't want to have to scroll through a whole website or a whole document to get there. I just want to be able to click on that and download it. Or I just want to click on, look at the National Park Service, standards, and just be able to click that and not scroll through a whole document. So the information is there, but it's been broken into separate links. And what I talked to Carlos about that I think may be really valuable is to reintegrate that into a complete document and have that also posted on there, because I could see a lot of value in sending that to applicants as a comprehensive document, and then also have it being separated. So if somebody wants to search for something specific, they could find that more easily. So I don't know if you have further questions or if I answered your concerns.
I know, because I know all of the people involved in doing that original document fairly well, that they deliberated and decided that the document should not read prescriptively. And I wonder, I mean, personally, as an architect and a visual person, I love the idea of showing people examples, but how do you show people examples and not have a document which is prescriptive? It says, do it like this, but if you do it like that, you'll never get a certificate of appropriateness.
I think that's why you don't show, like, we're not looking at like CDs or even really like design development documents when we're doing these graphics. I think you would need to provide enough examples of enough variability to show that there's multiple ways to meet these various standards. And I think that there's a lot of really good examples in Evanston, both of what to do and what not to do. And I don't think we'll have trouble finding multiple examples of preferred treatment types that really meet the standards. But I agree with you, you can't just show like, oh, here's one example, because there's countless examples, and there's examples being thought of and invented now to meet the same standards. I agree with you.
Topics, like component, like windows, or broken down by components? Is that how this would work?
That's typically how it's broken down. I don't have the outline right in front of me. I mean, it is pretty exhaustive, Stuart, but it's also underneath each one of those little segments, under a segment on like repointing or something. It's not a really lengthy testimony on each one of these. It might be, three or four sentences of what the preferred treatment type is. And then there might be, multiple photos of what not to do and what to do. So I think the outline looks very intimidating, and it looks like, oh, this is going to be a 1,000-page document. But that's not typically the case.
Do you have, maybe you furnished them to the subcommittee members. Did you have comprehensive guidelines from another community that you showed them?
I researched and I saw the ones in Aurora, Illinois, and the ones in Colorado, in Texas, San Antonio.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very comprehensive. I mean, those are very large documents. I think ours would not be as large, but I think the idea was from the beginning, when we only look at the standards for review, they really don't, it's sort of difficult to meet those standards without some examples. What can you do, And again, it's not like it's only one answer for that will fit the mold. There are different ways to maintain the integrity of these buildings. Sometimes you minimize the adverse effect by having alterations. What the reason you want to review it is because you want to minimize the adverse effect. There's always an effect when you alter, even if you do restoration or you put as modest addition, there will be an impact. So the idea is that you want to manage that change and you want to minimize any adverse effect. And that's why our ordinance works, because it does allow alteration.
And let me just pull one up on the screen, because I do think that San Antonio's, which Carlos mentioned, I think that is a really good example. And you can see here, you know, there's a lot of different bullet points here, but they're not providing a ton of very specific or prescriptive guidelines here. You talk about like, and some of this, Stuart, you're right. I mean, some of this has been dealt with already that we can integrate. But like similar roof form, you know, utilize a similar roof pitch form, overhang and orientation as a historic structure for additions. And then they'll show examples of what to do, what not to do. A good example, bad example, good example, bad example. And you can show even more photos than this, but some graphics here on different massings for additions. So I think this is generally what we're aiming for. It's not, there's not as much text as I think you would expect.
I know we saw a lot of this, you know, as we were collecting information when Julie and I were doing the solar, you know, sustainability guidelines. You know, it's just also particularly people who don't have our background or whatever and are coming at this, you know, everybody learns and understands different ways. And so we have to provide the information in a couple different ways, visual and text and whatever, and make it as searchable and clickable and accessible as possible, because, you know, I think our portion of the website is just kind of overwhelming when you go to it right now to look for things. And I think what we really need to do is just make it as friendly as possible for somebody that knows nothing about a structure.
And I think some of the intent in this document too is taking, because I agree with you, there's a lot of resources. It's good in a way compared to some of the other commissions. I mean, we do provide a lot of resources, but I agree that part of the intent of this effort should be to try to integrate a lot of that. I mean, there's information everywhere and it should really be integrated in a better way. And I think hopefully you would have, you know, four or five documents on there that integrates that information, adds new information, and then the rest maybe goes away. Because yeah, there's a lot right now. And it's mostly just text, which most people don't connect with. I mean, even comprehensive plans, large planning efforts now are more and more visual, or even a lot of municipalities are moving towards just like online plans. They don't have paper plans anymore.
Yeah, when I look at, you know, what was previously created, it's phenomenal. And it's almost like taking that and just like blowing it out more, trying not to make it prescriptive, but giving people, you know, some examples and guidance.
I think that the intent is to do that. And Kate and I get a lot of phone calls from people who basically all they want to do is get a permit, and they don't necessarily are thinking, you know, is my design going to meet the standards? And then when we get to that level, you know, they don't necessarily always in the best open-minded mode. So I think the graphics will help just to show them that, you know, we're not intending to stop them from doing what they want to do. It's just that there's ways to maximize the best way to integrate those alterations or additions or new construction into the historic district landmark. So this will help to do that. So I don't know if we answer all your questions, Stuart, but again, we want to make sure that there's no misunderstanding as far as the intent of the design guidelines. We want to make it more graphically and more friendly than we currently have with just the standards for review.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Carlos, you think it's worth responding to Julie and Jack about, you know, to reassure them that their work product will be used?
Yeah, I intend to do that anyway. I think that Kate had received an email from Julie, and I didn't see it in my inbox, the office, but I think it went to my personal email. So then at that point, it was a little bit too late for me to address, but I thought that telling the commission and Stuart particularly, you know, what the intent was, it would be important. It's on the record. And I will respond to Julie. And I don't know if there's other emails I have not been aware of, but whatever email coming from the former commissioners, I'll be happy to answer. And remember, I was part of that. So I was part of the group. So I also have my professional interest in making sure that, you know, we will continue providing good service to the commissioners as staff.
Thank you.
Can you guys hear me? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything else?
Cade, was there anything else set for the meeting?
No, I don't think so. The only other thing is at the next meeting, I'll bring a list of prospective dates for approval for the subsequent year. And I did ask, I don't know if it would interest you, we can talk about it then, but I asked for approval and got approval if you want to not have an August meeting next year. It just, I guess it's something we used to do, and it sets nice expectations up front for applicants, just knowing that that's a difficult time to get quorum. That's all I have.
Yeah. Just we didn't in the past where we didn't have a meeting in August, and I think the commissioner was well received, but then we have a volume of projects for the next month. So that's some of the consequences of that, that we will not necessarily diminish the number of projects that come along. But on the other hand, we have more administrative reviews that we didn't enjoy in the past. And I think that's helping a lot to reduce the volume of projects that's going around the commission. So.
Is it going to be on Tuesdays?
Can you repeat that again?
Oh, I just was wondering if the meeting is going to continue to be on Tuesdays. Tuesday night.
Are they still going to be on
Tuesdays? Tuesdays? Yeah, I'm sorry. The voice doesn't come.
Yeah, I don't know why.
It's okay. So we don't intend to change the date. Okay. We've been always the Tuesdays. The only change that happened, I think I can't remember how many years ago, but we used to have the first Tuesday of the month, and then we moved to the second Tuesday of the month. The other change we made is the number of days that we are asking applicants to submit instead of 10 days. Now we ask them to submit 15 business days prior to the meeting so that we have time to address some of the issues that we see are not conforming with the standards. We had a chance to talk to them so that it has helped to improve the quality of the projects for people who want to respond in a positive way.
And just a reminder, we meet a week earlier in December, so everybody is aware. December 7th, I think.
It is December 7th, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to say to you that Julie Hacker is going to have her final pre-review meeting in December.
That's
so
right.
If there's any other commissioners that really want to jump in and take her spot on free review with me, you're welcome to do so. Otherwise, I'll do it with Cade myself.
No one has to answer right now. It's a good time.
Yeah. I mean, we will miss Julie. She did a phenomenal job and was nice enough to do it for as long as she did. So.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm just confirming, you said that December's meeting is on the 7th, not the 14th?
Correct, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Same time. no other change.
All right. Hear a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you. Thanks, thank you, guys. And good night to all.
Bye, everybody.
Good night.
Bye-bye. Bye.